Hey everyone, my name's Robert.
And I'm Tim. This video series is about national parks that have played really important roles in the history of science.
This inaugural episode is about a famous ecological experiment conducted 50 years ago in Everglades National Park. We went to the park and met up with the scientist who did that experiment.
It's a really cool story. We hope you like it.
We're visiting Florida's Everglades. It's a place of marshes and woodlands, alligators and insects, people and history, mangrove islands, and very loud gulls. This is Dr. Dan Simberloff. Today, he's an ecologist at the University of Tennessee. 50 years ago, he was a graduate student at Harvard, studying under famous biologist Edward Wilson. Back then, he and Wilson designed an experiment to test a new theory about why some islands have more species than others. Ever since, that theory and the experiments that tested it have shaped the thinking of scientists and conservationists around the world.
So Dan, we are here in the middle of Florida Bay, which is actually part of Everglades National Park. And this is your old stomping ground, isn't it?
Yeah, I spent about 10 years of my life walking around in this muck looking for insects and spiders in these mangrove islands that you see around us. Even small islands like these ones behind us might have two or three species, and a larger one about the size of a large room might have 20 or so, and these very large islands that you see here could easily have 100 species of insects, spiders, millipedes, centipedes, etc.
You did a famous experiment here, an influential experiment, about 50 years ago. Could you tell us a little bit about it?
We conceived of the idea of looking at a group of these islands, censusing them very carefully to know exactly what species were on them, and then fumigating them the same way you would fumigate a house to remove all of these species, and then watch as it was recolonized, and for a while after that, to see if the same number of species came back, if it was the same species, and did this some species arrive and then disappear and then arrive again, et cetera, et cetera. And so that was the gist of the experiment. This is one of the islands that we fumigated and removed all the species from, and there's another one over there. It's nostalgic for me to be back here.
Fumigating some islands with an insecticide probably would not be allowed in a national park today, but the laws and policies were different 50 years ago. In the end, only a few islands were fumigated, the species came back as expected, and the park ecosystem as a whole was not harmed.
What makes biogeography so important on these mangrove islands?
It's not specifically these islands. These islands were to test a larger theory. We were particularly interested in that time in testing a theory that my doctoral advisor, Edward O. Wilson, had evolved with another ecologist, Robert MacArthur. And their idea was that we can go out and look at all the species on a particular island, and we'll see that there are 107 species, say. And we can come back 10 years later, and there'll still be around the same number of species. But they suggested there'd be somewhat different ones. So the number of species stays about the same. So that was their general idea.
Would you say these islands are almost like an apartment building with a transient population? So you have the young college students who move in, then they move out when they can't keep up with the rent, then the older couple moves in, and et cetera.
I had not ever thought to use that metaphor, but it's a good one.
So what was the result of their experiment? After they removed all the species of bugs, Simberloff and Wilson watched as species returned by migrating from other places. After a few months, all of the islands ended up with about the same number of species they had started with, but the actual species present were a bit different from what they had been at the beginning. Their experiment, along with later experiments, showed that small islands had fewer species than bigger islands, and faraway islands had fewer species than nearby islands. That's because islands of different sizes and distances had different rates of extinction and immigration. All of this is what the mathematical theory of island biogeography predicted, so the experiment confirmed the model. Of course, there's always a bit of adventure when doing science.
I had one experience that was staggering. I was on a small island, and off in the distance, I saw a water spout. There was black clouds and this snake-like narrowing thing coming down, and you would see pieces of wood going up and you'd see things coming down. There was nothing we could do. We couldn't make a run for it. And it went a different way.
But why did any of this matter? What effect has the experiment and the underlying theory of island biogeography had on our world? Turns out it's important not just for species of bugs on mangrove islands in a bay, but for biodiversity as a whole on islands of many types, even places we might not usually think of as islands.
So a national park like Everglades itself can be thought of as an island. Do your studies of biodiversity on these islands that you can work with have some implications for biodiversity of, say, national parks of different sizes around the world?
You know, even at that time, we recognized that kind of potential relevance. We weren't thinking initially of national parks. We were thinking of like a forest surrounded by fields where all the rest of the forest was cut down, or a lake, which is far from any other lake, or a field surrounded by forest. And then later, as you know, we did this work and I did other experiments, we and others began to think about protected areas like national parks. And the real relevance was that we were showing occasional extinction of species on these small islands. And the smaller the islands, the more frequently there were these local extinctions. And so the implication is that if a site is very small, it probably puts the species on it in danger of occasional extinction.
So what do others have to say? We talked to some other scientists and conservationists to get their take.
Understanding that concept and the principles of how island size and distance from other fragments, other islands, affects the species composition and diversity is really important to help us set expectations about what species will occur there and how our management might further affect the remaining biodiversity that does occur.
I work for the Fish and Wildlife Service as a program officer for the Rhino Tiger Conservation Fund and the Great Ape Conservation Fund, and we support projects in Asia. So the small protected areas typically cannot hold a substantial number of animals, so they have to disperse. But being that they are in these small islands, they would need to get to another island if they have to continue existence, so to speak. And if we have a lot of separation between these small protected areas, the likelihood of extinction is also fairly large, and we are actually dealing with those sorts of issues.
I still remember learning about that experiment. To think that they went out in the mangroves, they erected these structures and closed them off and fumigated them and cleared everything so that then they could reassess how they were colonized was just a really great example of an elegant experiment to be able to precisely answer the question that they wanted to answer.
Well, there you have it. Everglades National Park, a bold experiment and an influential idea that's still useful today.
Yeah, that story is a really nice example of how our national parks are great for science. Everglades National Park and all the other parks still support research today, even if they might not allow the fumigation of islands.
It was a fun story to tell. Check back in to see more stories of national parks in the history of science.
See you next time.
There's another hollow twig. Let's see what's in it. Oh, there's something in that one too. Another chromatogaster. Yep. Great place.